Please give a warm applause to Stefan Gerling for his talk on how to hack a yacht.
Yeah, thank you to be here. It's a nice opportunity for me to speak at a Troopers the first time. So it's also my first Troopers. So never been here before. So I will see. Maybe I can make you happy a little bit. I think I do so. So the topic of my talk is about yachts. And
send a flu shot.
Rabbit, flu shot, someone talk to me.
A rabbit replicates till it overloads a file, then it spreads like cancer.
Cancer? It's the Gibson, it's finding us too fast.
We should look in the whole video.
There's too many garbage files. I need more time.
Okay, that was only a short introduction. This was in the movie Hackers from 96. So there already they hacked some super tankers, and that was not giving the idea about that, so it was a different story. Yeah. That's the short agenda. Who am I? About yachts and ships. So what is the difference to have a small marina one by one, so that you have a little bit knowledge about which kind of systems are on modern yachts and modern ships, to get an idea about how they interact. So that's a little bit mandatory. And then we look at some different attack vectors where you can do something with the ships. And at last, then I show you bugs in a marina router that I found. So it's an common router that you can build up for the internet access there. And that actually gave also my idea about to dig deeper in this topic. So I'm Stefan Gerling. So you can find me on Twitter under Obi-Wan666. By the way, I'm older than the internet. I have some certifications like CISSP or GCFA. From the background, I'm an electrician and electronic specialist. I worked a couple of years in the German army, and we are there responsible for maintaining navigation systems on helicopters. And in that time, I joined also some military missions in some nice areas. On the other hand, I'm a volunteering firefighter since 30 years, so that's my real hobby and my passion. So I know it to be under fire. I'm working at the Rosen Group in the oil and gas industry. I show you a little bit later about that. Of course, I avoid warranties, and I'm a member of Graffel, one is here, and I'm the Calvary. Yeah. In my company, we take care about oil and gas stuff. So we inspecting oil and gas pipelines. That's where our company makes the money with. And of course, they doing so much taking care about security. And that's where I'm working in that group, to take care about new threats against our stuff. But this with the yachts is not related to our company. So it's only a short introduction what I'm normally doing. Yeah, there were some accidents last year, so that I remembered when I started it. So a container vessel in February was not accessible via the navigation system. So they lost connection to the navigation system for 10 hours. They had to reboot their system to get it running again, and then they had access to the systems again. So there was only a short story about that. I not seen any other information about it, only that it happened. I find no report about that. Yeah, the next things are GPS jamming. They found it a little bit more. I come back later in some other slides on that. And the USS Navy had four accidents in the Eastern Pacific Sea. So there were the people already complaining about, did they hack the naval ships from the US or not? So rumors coming up more and more, but one of the reports I've read completely, so it was a completely human error about bad teaching of them, at the wrong time was the wrong person on the bridge and so on. So when you look, for example, for the USS Fitzgerald collision with a freighter, there you can find the real story about it. So yeah, these are then some things on the newspapers that you can find in there. Hackers targeting ships industries. Hacker kapert Yacht per Laptop. So by the way, this was a test where they spoofed the GPS signals and moved the ship around in a different way. So they're doing things like this. They're becoming more and more news articles about naval threats about, and yeah, so that's when I started then. So vessels, yacht, and ships. A yacht is more or less a recreational ship, and the background from that is originally it was a Dutch hunting ship, because of the word yacht is a Dutch word for hunting. And they use these yachts for hunting pirates in some other areas of the of the waters of the Netherlands. So size matters. So if you own a yacht, size matters. When you look up all the people, there was a story about Abramovich and one from Saudi Arabia. So the Saudi Arabian people had built a bigger boat than from Abramovich, so Abramovich sent it to Blumenfors. I need some meters more, so they cut it in half, put some meters extra in it, and extended it and upgraded it also. So we have small boats up to 7 meters. We have a yacht. Then we're talking about already from 10 meters or 33 feet. Super yachts are from 24 meters up to whatever, but there is a next classification. Mega yachts are everything else below 50 meters. So when you have 164 feet, then you have a super yacht. This is one one of these super yachts. So someone looking these amazing the Geissen story on RTL2, there you can find the story about the billionaires or millionaires. They're showing their ship there. So I take that from a marinetraffic.com website. So it's a yacht from 38 meters. And what's on it, on those things, is more or less swimming IoT. So we have systems like vessel traffic services, automatic information systems, autopilot, GPS, radar, camera, including also thermal imaging cameras. We have engine control and monitoring systems, internet access, and entertainment systems. So when you already look at this list, you can easily spot some areas where you maybe could find some threats or interacting points, how to get in that. So the basic network of a ship, it's on the NMEA network. So it's from the National Marine Electronic Association, a standardized bus, and it's differentiated in different systems. So it started with the NMEA 0183 network. It's combining all the systems together, echosonars, sonar, anemometers, gyro compass, autopilot, GPS receivers, and many others. So it's a serial bus, and they're working up in speed 4,800 baud speed. So it's not that much, but it works. With newer systems, they need more speed. So they then introduce the NMEA 2000 network. This is now a complete CAN bus network. it's the same topology, but they have using different protocol on it, this Anemia protocol. The funny thing is the Anemia protocol is clearly defined. So anyone who wants to have a certified system that is working on this Anemia bus has to be certified against the National Marine Electronic Standards. And then you get certified and that's it. So you can easily read up how it is working, what kind of message is it, how the message must be looked up, and so on. So in the car hacking stuff, you have you find out yourself how it works. So in that stuff, you only have to read to get an idea about it. So they're connecting everything together. Yeah. By the way, because it's Anemia, it's a Cambus technology, it's not working together, but there are gateway devices for that. So here we have an overview about how it looks like. So this is a normal yacht, size doesn't matter in this time. So we have a complete network bus going through the ship. It ends with a terminator resistor. And here we have one of those gateway from the serial network to the CAN bus network. So there are gateways for that. And of course, there are gateways from the Anemia gateway to the computers. So this is, in this case, is a USB gateway, but there are also TCP/IP gateways for that. So this is how then the cabling looks like. A little bit confusing, but they're using all these T connectors, and it's more or less looking like the cheaper net from the older days. And also the fact that you use a trunk terminator resistor at the end. So at the front, at the end, there must be a terminator, otherwise it doesn't work correctly. CTORC NG, it's just another word for Anemia 2000. It's introduced by Ray Marine, so they use their own names and some extensions for that, but it's completely compatible to the normal network. So here you can see already a bunch of systems that are working with that. Some engine controllers, heading, bearing stuff, wind sensors, remote control for autopilot. That's, by the way, this part. So here's the remote control receiver and the handheld for that. GPS and everything else. And they have also another standard. It's already called CTORC High S for high speed network for new entertainment stuff. So they are including more and more entertainment stuff also in those networks. You can also look up, there's a small link here. Later on, when I give away the presentation, you can look up yourself or just searching for that. Okay, then I wrote a network map how it looks like, from my understanding. So we have some kind of internet access, there is the normal network, and then we have some gateways, and then we coming to the boat network. So, but that we look on later. So to get a better idea about the internal things, yeah. Vessel Transformation, Vessel Traffic Services, the AIS, Automatic Identification System, Electronic Chart Display and Information System, and Autopilot and Internet Access. So how they are working. The Vessel Traffic Service is like in the airplane stuff, like the flight controllers for aero industry. So it's a monitoring system by harbors or port authorities, yeah, similar to air traffic control, and using radar, closed circuit television, CCTV, and VHF radio telephony, and this is important, automatic information system, automatic identification system, sorry. So that you will find on most of everything. So the automatic information system itself. It is on bigger boats. On charter yachts, it is mandatory. On yachts more than 300, no, on boats more than 300 tons gross weight, these are mandatory things, and everything below you can do it when you want. But when you have it, it must be switched on. It is there are two systems: the normal VHF stuff or over satellite. So how they working? It's a little bit different. It should be only a supplemental marine. AIS should supplement the marine radar. So in the aircraft there was a GPS, and you was not supposed to rely only on the GPS system. You must be able always to navigate by hand. So that's why the people use the pilots and also the captains, they're using GPS as it is, but they must be clear that it could be jammed or disturbed in any way. So that's why traditional navigation is always a must-have for them. So that's also why it is a primary method of collision avoidance for water transport. So yeah. Then we have this electronic chart display and information system. So this is some kind of, you have navigation maps where you have to navigate about the water seas or in the high sea or whatever. It looks like, here you see a river and where you have the navigation points. You see here deep information about where you have to go, and then you can find your way through that. So, and even here, the ECDs is getting its speed also from the AIS system. So again, the AIS is submitting the information that it has and get from the GPS and putting it into the other systems there. So we use there here the position, the heading, and the speed. Then we have the IT equipment on board. For example, we need internet access, that you have access on the ships, a GSM, Wi-Fi, and SAT. And it is used for entertainment systems, for Wi-Fi, for the crew, for the owner, for guests, however, and some voice over IP things also. So this is from a bigger yacht, the server rack that we are taking a picture from. So when you look at here, so you easily see that that is already a complete full rack of stuff. So who will update those things? Who will take care on that? So they build it once in, and nobody take care about anything else on those things, unless maybe they go to an maintenance service, then they maybe get be updated, but I don't think so. So from on that boat where I do some stuff on, it was equipped with 10 smart TVs, one chart PC, 14 voice over IP telephones. So every room was equipped with one. We had one internet router for GSM or Wi-Fi or SAT communication. Then a complete full equipped 84 port switch, an uninterruptible power supply, 4 Wi-Fi access points, and that's it. So here you see it. By the way, they had 3 rack servers for all the systems with virtual machines on where all the stuff is connected. So, and yeah. The things on the boat is completely controlled over an iPad, for example. So you had an iPad with all the systems on it, where you can do maybe shut down the curtains, switch on the light, or you can have access to the engine control system to look up how the speed of the engine is, how the fuel filling is, or the radar is connected, or so on. So, and then with these things, then I looked up again at my chart, and then we can easily figure out that we have some kind of ACTED vectors about over the internet router. So when the thing has some internet access, or we can targeting the endpoint computers on maybe from the captain by sending them spoofed emails or spammed, phishing emails or something like that. Or we manipulating the handhelds, the mobile phone or the tablets. And research has to be done on those gateways. So once you are in a network, you have to search for one of those gateways. And when you find those gateways, you can then also attacking over the internet a way through down to the NMEA bus. But there should be also some other ways around. So yeah, as we figured out, we have some different attack vectors: GPS, AIS, autopilot, the IT equipment, and cloud-based services. Cloud-based services, wait, later. GPS. Spoofing is not that easy, but it's possible. So the newspaper thing showed it already. So you can do it now for, let's say, about 1,000 euro in equipment. You can spoof GPS signals. So more or less, you have to have more than three valid satellite signals to get a proper position, and that you have to fake with spoofed signals. So that's the thing that is a little bit tricky. So more or less, it's easier to fake the NMEA data of the GPS sensors. When the GPS gets the information and put it on the NMEA bus, and when you directly send a faked GPS messages after that, it will, the system will then using this signal. Spoofing, how GPS is working. So we have different things. In the US using the Navstar, Russian using GLONASS. In Germany we are, or in European, we are trying to build up our Galileo. It's still not finished. And China is also doing their own GPS things and putting the Baidu and then on the air, so with some satellites. The similarity is they only using three bands where they're operating: the L1, L2, and L5 band. And the difference are only in the frequencies they're using. They're close together, even in the L1 and L2. So you only have to jam a couple of those frequencies, and GPS is done. Yeah, the possible scenarios are GPS jamming and GPS spoofing. The spoofing is a little bit complicated, but not impossible. And jamming, it's quite easy. Just use your hack RF and a big antenna, and you can flat out and complete GPS band. So jamming will occur quite often. So in the Eastern Pacific, we had last year quite unusual anomalies in that area. So in June, there were more than 20 reports on ships, on aircraft, that there are anomalies in the GPS signals, and they had improper navigation system where they are. So at that time, there was a big NATO maneuver. So there could be some similarities in that area. And in September, the same thing. In Norway, there was a disruption also in the GPS signal. So when you get within plane higher than 2,000 feet, then the coordinating were completely unavailable. So then the Norwegian then take a helicopter going up with a targeted antenna, and then make a 360 degree around, and they figured out that the GPS jamming signal coming more or less from the Norway looking up somewhere from the Russian area. So they did not know from where it really come. It's only from the eastern area. So someone were spoofing and jamming those signals in that area. So when we now know, so GPS is quite often, how we can protect from that. So securing GPS is already a topic from the DLR. So they're having a project, they call it Galant, and it tries to filter out by suppressing interference and multipath signals and improving the reception of information signals from the direction of the satellite. So they have, here we can see it, they have an antenna array, 2x2 antennas, And with these antenna areas, they are able to figure out from which direction some signals are coming, and by knowing the time where you are, you can easily see, okay, we know the position of the satellite, and we know the incoming signal, maybe the jamming signal. And by correlating all those information, you can easily amplifying that signal that should be valid, and noise down the faked or spoofed GPS signals. So it's a nice project. They're still testing it. It seems really good. And I think in future we will see it on more and more systems. So they, I think, will put it smaller and smaller, and yeah. Coming back to the AIS stuff. So this is what the AIS system is really doing. A bunch of information. So every 2 to 10 seconds they send information while they are underway. So information like the MMS IE, similar to the mobile phone IMSI. The status are MI under anchor or underway, under or not under command. Maybe I have an failure from the engine or something like that. My speed over ground, my other and some other information. Looks a little bit confusing. So this is what you see then when you looked up all those information. So the identification number, so the IMO is the unique ship number, and the MMIS ID is from the AIS system. Then we have the call sign on the radio, under which flag a ship is running, if it is a pleasure craft or a cargo freighter or whatever. And on the other side, we see also the date, time, and the correct position where it is. Status, if it is moored, or the speed when it is driving, and so on. So I think I have it twice here, no matter. So, and every 6 minutes there are going the other informations. So all these things, when you know how the system is working, can then be used to look up for other stuff. So, yeah, the AIS RF part, when it is not going over satellite, it's communicating over VHF transponders. So they are operating in a band of 161 megahertz and 162 megahertz. So it's in the VHF bands 87B and 88B. So before being transmitted, AIS measures must be NIZY encoded. How those encoding must work, it's also not that bad. And all those things are GMSK modulated. And the transmission rate is not more than 9,600 bit. So how to look up those stuff? There is an RTL-SDR project running. So take your HackRF, put those SDR stuff in your GNU-RS, and then you can already read those informations. So when you now want to fake informations, you have to do a little bit different there, but then you are doing already illegal stuff. But yeah, I know that it will be done in maneuvers, so that they fake other ships to have a bigger plot about, okay, we are for the training purpose, then okay, here is our ship, and there are some other naval ship running there, so it looks a little bit better for them on the bridge. That is not only but you can do it also on yourself. Just put in a sending part in there and look up how the signal have to work, and that's it. So for a receiving point, it's already easy with that. Then we have, what I figured out was a friend of mine had a sailing yacht. And the sailing yacht has a remote handheld for the autopilot. So, okay, what's that? I had to figure out. So I looked up a little bit. So Raymarine, they have an autopilot system, and for that you have a remote control. And this remote control, looking up like this, so on the right we have the receiver, on the left the handheld, and it is wireless. Okay, when it is wireless, it must transmit some signals. How it is working. So I had not the stuff in place at that time. So I just looking up over the FCC ID search, every transmitter that is standardized and used in US have to be legalized over the FCC ID website. So when you're using, when you look up systems in that, you easily find all the information you have, want to have. So I looked up for Raymarine and a remote control and autopilot, and then I find this PG5 smart device. Yeah, Mücken and Law says if a device is smart, it is vulnerability. It communicates with the autopilot system, it operates on 2.45 gigahertz, and it's not Wi-Fi. So, okay, it's not Wi-Fi, there must be something else inside. So the nice thing on the FCC ID website is all the information needed are there. There are PDF documents that you can read, and then they get you a teardown about the electronics, how they look up, the system that are built in, and from that information, you then see, okay, they're using an Atmega 64 microprocessor on a frequency band and running an EmberStack wireless protocol on it. So this is how the radio communication module is working, and it's using an EmberStack protocol. So then you have to look up only how to this EmberStack protocol is working, and yeah, that's where I'm currently working on. So I have all the information that I needed now. So now I have to call my friend in April. I will travel to him because he has a yacht with a remote control. And we then gamble on the weekend with those remote control and try to figure out if it is possible to inject messages. So we are both in a good feeling that it should be possible, but we're not sure. So. But I think, we are positive that it worked. Now we're coming to the yacht router hacking stuff. So when the ship is underway, we need a way over the internet to get in it. So some of them have an internet router, and this brand from Loco Marine is a yacht router that I had in my hand. It looks like this. So here we have the router module itself. It has three antenna, two are for GSM, and one antenna is for Wi-Fi. And this is a Wi-Fi booster with an external antenna, and more, it's mostly placed on the outside, on the beam where all the other antennas are mounted. So this Wi-Fi, this complete system is an standard MikroTik things. So this Wi-Fi booster you can buy at MikroTik for 100 euros. And this is also a MikroTik router with a different enclosure about it. So, and they put it all together. So the booster has 1.6 watt electrical power. With the right antenna on, I had a 15 dB antenna, so I had around about 25 watt on electrical power on the Wi-Fi signal, and this is then able to have Wi-Fi for more than 15 nautical miles. So you're on the sea and can have access up to 15 nautical miles. Or up to 30 nautical miles with 2G. So I was not able to test if it is really that far away, because I only tested in the harbor, but yeah, I think it should work. So that's far enough, I think. This is a software that is used for controlling those router. So after build up everything, I tested the system, connecting to the internet via Wi-Fi, via GSM, and so on. Everything worked. Then, after everything working, so at the evening, then I was sitting there with the captain, drinking a bottle of wine, started my laptop again, and okay, now everything is working. How it is working? So, put my Wireshark out, and. Looked what they are transmitting over the Wi-Fi when I use my console software to connect to the router to change those settings. So here you can change the Wi-Fi settings, multimedia, and whatever. So I wanted to know how they worked. So Wireshark is then my friend. What I then saw, okay, they connect via FTP to the router. So what the fuck? Then I saw they downloading an XML file, and every change that I put in the configuration of the router software is then transmitted via FTP again as this XML file to the router. So it was a small upload then. As you all know, FTP is some kind of clear text. They're using hard-coded credentials. And the XML files, I don't have to explain what they are in. So this is then the log of the FTP connection, the user loco. I think in Spain it's some, the name should be crazy, yeah. It's a crazy system. So user loco, and the password is secure connecting user, yeah. Yeah, because it's FTP, it's clear text, it's secure. Yeah, that's the complete command then, where you then also can see, okay, binary mode, yacht router, gen 3 XML file. Yeah. And secondly, then I looked up, okay, when they're using that stuff, I look up in the binaries of the software. So it was a .NET application. I put it in .NET Reflector or in ILSpy I used in that case. And then when you look up via ILSpy through the .NET application, you then also see some other things like selected one Franjo 2, Jere, that we have to remember for later. And I don't know what this kind is, but it looks nice. And then I came to the good engine, the JR engine, could be JRouter engine. And there, the complete configuration for the FTP is putting in. Nice thing is you can go to the download page of the manufacturer, download the software, put it to the ILSpy, and then you find those things. Yeah. Then the next step I tried, okay, when it is using FTP, maybe there is more. So I took my Nmap out. And when you make an Nmap scan on the system, there's no firewall connected, either from the internal or from the outside. From the internet, you can easily do an Nmap scan and you find all those open ports also. So, ouch. When you have access via SSH, you will have a complete remote console to work on it. And it is working from outside. Then I looked up further, they have some kind of remote support. So you click on a button, connect for remote support, and that's it. So you have to call them saying, my router has a problem, please take care about that. And then you give the information what time they should access it, and that's it. So they don't want to know an IP address or something like that. So, okay, how are they using this? They only wanted the router model and serial number and where they get the IP address from. Every time you connect, the thing is pinged back at home. Okay, that's good. Where the IP address is belonging to, okay, it's belonging to the manufacturer Locomarine. They have their own IP addresses and yeah, they're connecting to. So now, when you remember the port scan, there were some ports open. So the MikroTik router have a remote management port, 8291 TCP. So there is also a management software for that, the Winbox management software, where you easily connect to that. So the Yacht Router software itself has no ability to change firewall settings or something like that. So when you connect with the Winbox management software, you have full access to the system and you can change everything what you want. And the nice thing is the local user has full access. It's like root. So there you can look up wireless settings, interface settings. You can also set up the firewall and changing other behaviors and all that stuff. So when you look then to the management, to the user thing, so here we have again the user Jere. It is one of the developers there. And here's the normal user that is connecting to the system. Okay. But on the other hand, when you have no access to that and no idea about the password, there is also a project running, MKBrutus, so you can using it for brute force attacking to the router controller and try to get the right password. But I think yesterday or so, I saw a tweet about MikroTik router. They had some new problems, so yeah, I have to look up, because I have a testing device still there. So now we have an idea about how we can connect. So let's find a yacht. I again taking one of the websites. So they announcing some ships where they built on the systems. So now I want to know where are those ships are. So let's take the Cantina. I go to the marinetraffic.com website, then you can go to search and then put in the name Cantina and then you find it. And then you can have the information about the AIS, where it is at that time, what is the estimated thing where the next travel is going to, and so on. And you also can look up then information about, it's working in the Adria Sea, it's currently moored, and that's it. So that's one way to look where it is. This information we had already. And on the other hand, you can also use Shodan. So look at Shodan for the specific ports of the MikroTik router, or looking only for names like Yacht. And then you see here, this is one example that I done December last year. So it is a ship on the Themse above. So it's sailing there, has an IP address. Those kind of ports are open, and then you can easily look up for that and trying default passwords on that. So sometimes you find one that is online, and you can gamble with that. So Shodan is sometimes your friend. Then I contacted the vendor. So the I contacted them in June last year, and then on the next day they gave me already an email about, oh yeah, thank you for that. We already fixed two of the bugs. The rest we are working on. The rest we are working on took 6 months. Not really 6 months, but in November. They had a complete new finally version about the software, and then they changed all the systems. So yeah, I requested a CVE ID. It's not published yet. It's only registered. And in the second mail already asking for permission from the vendor to present it. So the funny answer was, you can present it because we cannot prevent it any. So it's up to you. So then I decided, okay, when I'm able to present it, I wait for the final patch and then I will start to talk about. So yeah, then they patched the system. And then I was asking, so can I test the patch? And they sent me then a test router for that. And I tested then the new Windows version. So what I've done then, it's still a .NET application, and I try to decompile it with ILSpy, for example. And yeah, they obfuscated everything. All my decompiler are crashing at that time, so I had no idea so how to prevent that. So I asked a friend, THS, can you help me about that? So he played a little bit around with that and gave me already a deobfuscated version of that. And we looked up for that further. So in the deobfuscated version, you already see how they are working. So then the next thing then I tried, okay, they have also an iOS version and they have an Android version. So in rooted iOS I don't have, so I take the Android version, downloaded the APK, put the APK, yeah, extracted it, put the APK through ILSpy and looked up what's happened there. So, and the funny thing was they obfuscated all the Windows stuff and forgot about the binaries on the Android things. So, and this is then the JR engine again, and here you see Crazy Loco is still there. They have a new password, and they're changing the old password to the new one. So that's what they've done, but they have obfuscated. So and still using the things, but. What I have good done is, yeah, another funny thing is this one I found and also patch backbone data leak. So I don't know where it is for, but they have some things in there. The good thing is they're using now SSH instead of FTP. They obfuscated the Windows versions, but forgot about the Androids. iOS, I don't know what they've done there. So I have to find a way to test it, but on the other hand, if there are other ways, so why put their effort in? So they still hard-coded credential using and no firewall for that. So I sent them again incomplete information about that. So so far I got not a response yet, but I'm waiting for them. I also give them a complete explanation what I had expected in front of them. So a default password, why not, could be used. But the first step on installing the software should be then set a new password. So all these things were not implemented in the software. So that I was saying them, so why you don't using something like that? Yeah, I'm waiting for that. Okay, so coming to the future from that, so those NMEA stuff needs more testing. So I think there is the Fraunhofer Institute is now doing a research project and wanted to test exactly that. The wireless autopilot I'm working on, I think I will have in summer new ideas about that. Other internet routers I'm looking also up, so I'm searching all the time now for different router models, if there are software is public available, downloading them, decompiling them, looking for nice stuff from that. Yeah, vessel hacking is still in the beginning, but the vendors are starting already with cloud services. So when you're then thinking about cloud services, so what the fuck? So they connecting, this is from the NMEA.org website. So this is a good source for get information about how NMEA is working and some kind of the protocols and how this stuff tier together. And here you have already an overview about what's next. So you have everything connected through an IP gateway to the Ethernet on board. And this is then connected via cloud services to the endpoints. So What then could happen? I don't know. If the application on the endpoints are developed in a proper way, we will see. So once I have one of those systems to test, I will try what's going on. So this is, for example, then one of those cloud services that you can access via a tablet, for example, from home. You can look up engine parameters like RPM, oil pressures, fuel flow. This is for both engines. The engine temperature, you have radar indication, how it is working. You can also have access to the cameras on board, engine parameters, power supply, navigation information, and so on. So this is what they are planning more and more, that you have remote access from every place of the world to your ship, what is currently rented or whatever. So yeah, I think in the future we will hear more about that. As I already mentioned, research project is just started. IOActive did some nice stuff on the VSAT things. VTS, I think it's not really explored yet. Autopilot, yeah, as I mentioned, I'm working on it. Injecting MEA, NMEA protocols is also for, yeah, it's running. And the GPS spoofing protection is also underway. So, as my conclusion, maritime security is still in the beginning. We will see what happened next. Then I come to the end. Thanks for the attention. And when you want to contact me, this is where you get me. Thank you.
Thanks for this great talk.